More variety.
You're listening to Para X. So what are you doing Memorial Day weekend? Join the gang from Beyond Ghost for the premier horror para conference in the Western New York area. You can literally hang with all of your favorites. Scream Queen Melantha Blackthorn, horror legend Lloyd Kaufman, see Christine the car that was made famous in Stephen King's novel. You can be a part of a paranormal investigation of the famous Buffalo Central Terminal. Or you can take part in the infamous Zombie Walk. Horror and the paranormal come together Memorial Day weekend at the Buffalo Central Terminal. And yes, Para X's Black Cat Lounge will be there serving up fun. So get your tickets now. Check them out at beyondghost.com. And as always, tell them that the Rev sent you.
On October 11, 2012, Barry Fitzgerald will be leaving Ireland and heading to Africa to climb Africa's highest point and the highest freestanding mountain in the world, Mount Kilimanjaro, in aid of Oxfam Ireland. Oxfam is a global movement of people, people passionate about justice, working together to overcome the injustice of poverty worldwide. They believe that in a world rich of resources, poverty is neither natural nor inevitable. All human beings have rights to a home, enough to eat, clean water, a way to make a living, education, health care, freedom from violence, a voice, and an identity. The mental and physical challenges Barry and his teammates will be facing will be amazingly difficult. But not nearly as difficult as the everyday lives of those they will be challenging themselves for. A simple donation to sponsor Barry's climb will go a long way in changing people's lives. Help him make a difference by visiting the Para X website at www.para-x.com and contributing to the cause. Those who donate $5 or more will receive a wristband commemorating this monumental event. Please donate today and help Barry challenge poverty.
Hi, Barry McGuire here, inviting you to come along with Marla Brooks and let's start stirring the cauldron together on Para X.
Everyone, it's Marla. If you like tonight's episode of Stirring the Cauldron and the archive podcast as well, take a look at the show's YouTube channel and check out the dozens of shows that are there just waiting to be heard. New shows are added each week, and while you're there, why not subscribe? It's free. And if you click on that tiny little bell icon at the top of the page, you'll be notified when new shows are available. Just go to youtube.com and then type in Stirring the Cauldron Para X and the link will appear. Just like magic.
Thank you. Stirring the Cauldron. Now, here's your host, Marla Brooks.
Oh. Merry meet everybody, and welcome to Stirring the Cauldron on the Para-X Radio Network. Before we get started, I'd like to ask you all to go to the Para-X website at www.para-x.com, and under the main menu, click on the Mount Kilimanjaro climb link, and help Ghost Hunters International's Barry Fitzgerald, who will be making a treacherous climb up Mount Kilimanjaro in October of this year on behalf of Oxfam Ireland. Not only will you be helping a worthy cause, but Para-X would like to give you something in return. With a donation of $5 or more, you'll receive a commemorative wristband with the words, Reaching the Top with Barry. All net proceeds from the wristbands will go to the charity, and even the smallest donation can go a long way in changing someone's life in more ways than you can imagine. You can also help by spreading the word. Just share the YouTube video on your Facebook, MySpace, blog, or website. All right, that being said, we're going to talk about a fascinating subject tonight with author Dr. Kirby Surprise, who wrote a book called Synchronicity, The Art of Coincidence, Choice, and Unlocking Your Mind. And if anybody has any questions, please go to the private messages and send them over to me, and we will get them on the air. Now, Dr. Surprise has a doctorate in counseling psychology and works in an advanced outpatient program for the state of California, where he assesses, diagnoses, and treats clients with psychotic and delusional disorders. And it should be no surprise that to some, the idea of synchronicity may be a bit delusional, or at the very least, nonsensical. But we're going to work that all out tonight, so please join me in welcoming Dr. Kirby Surprise. Hi, Dr. Surprise, and thank you for joining me tonight.
Thank you for having me on the show.
You know, I think a good place to start is at the beginning. And why don't we start out by explaining what synchronicity is? Because some people pass it off as odd coincidence, others look at it as some kind of an omen of some sort, and some people discount it altogether.
Well, the simplest definition of a synchronistic event is an event where something you're thinking or feeling seems to be reflected back at you in the environment. There are coincidences that occur that seem to be directed at you and have some meaning involved. In psychiatry, we call them thoughts of reference. Somebody's having a thought, and they believe that an event in the environment is somehow referencing what they're thinking. Commonly, people will say, well, you know, I was having this conversation with a friend of mine, and there was a radio TV on in the background, and I would swear the announcer said something that commented on our conversation. That kind of coincidence.
Mm-hmm. Is there a definitive difference between synchronicity and coincidence?
Synchronistic events have meaning to them. You know, of course, you know, random events line up all the time in interesting patterns. Synchronicity seem to be sort of impossibly beat the odds for regular coincidence. So there are things that they sort of pop out of the environment, not just, you know, oh, that happened to be happening at the same time as something else.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so it's your theory that synchronistic events and coincidence are created primarily by our own minds. So here's an example of a synchronistic event that happened to me this week, and I'll hit you up with a follow-up question after I explain it. On Monday, a producer of a popular television show emailed me to see if I had any leads to haunted residences here in L.A. because they were scouting for upcoming shows. And I gave him one off the top of my head, and that was that. Tuesday morning, I get an email back from him saying, "Funny you should have mentioned that particular house because I was just there." And I wrote back, "Even funnier because this week my show topic is synchronicity." So how could I influence this particular event if it was synchronistic, because it was completely random, out of the blue, and nothing I would have consciously even subconsciously projected into anything?
Synchronicity is not a simple phenomenon. The unfortunately long, short version of the answer is we are a lot more than we are know ourselves to be on the surface. Mm-hmm. For instance, in purely psychological terms, most of our brain is made of automated processes. Our conscious awareness, the part we think of as us, is mm-hmm. about the size of a walnut on the very front of the brain, on the frontal lobe. The rest of it is doing the miraculous math of creating the world we see around us and navigating us through it. But beyond that, there are parts of us that are not purely physical that are doing things in the background. And what I'm saying is that synchronistic events are created by parts of ourselves in the same way that dreams are created by parts mm-hmm. of ourselves. We're not immediately aware of the process, but mm-hmm. it's us doing it. At the very least, it's us that is determining that there is a meaning or special relationship involved. Mm-hmm. The explanation that I give is that, you know, we don't create reality, but we have about a 5 or 6% influence on changing the events around us. So mm-hmm. just by the fact that you're thinking about a particular topic or focusing your attention in a certain way changes the odds that those patterns will appear in the environment around us.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Now, I just got a question from the chat room. Ceiling Cat is asking, she said, "Doesn't Kabbalah explain some synchronicity? Mathematics of words begat similar or subsequential even..." Yeah, subsequential events. She said, "Follow-up, is the chaos theory really chaos or predictable events once the language is deciphered?"
All right, let me make my view simpler than that.
Okay.
All right. Some people keep pet birds in cages, and sometimes you'll find they put a mirror in the cage with the bird. The reason the mirror is there is to keep the little bird company. The bird is not smart enough to know that the reflection of himself in the mirror is a reflection. They think it's another bird. And mm-hmm. they'll squawk at it, and they'll argue with it, and they'll talk to it, and they'll peck at it. But the birds never fully realize that what they're looking at is a reflection. I'm saying that synchronistic events are mostly reflections of our own thoughts and emotions, not only our conscious processes, but things that are going on unconsciously or even spiritually as well. So that if someone wants to see patterns of the Kabbalah or that philosophy manifesting in synchronistic events, they certainly will see that because their thoughts carry those presumptions out into the patterns made in the environment. But mm-hmm. the same thing works with anybody's belief system and anybody's thought pattern. So you can find meaning regardless of how you look, because you're looking at parts of yourself.
Okay. Now, in your book, there's the Taoist story of the Rainmaker.
Yes.
And I thought that was really interesting, although it seems a little bit more cosmic in nature. Can we discuss that for a second?
Okay. There's several stories in the book. Which one are you talking about?
It's the story of the Rainmaker who was brought to a village in hopes of ending a serious drought,
right.
And
yes.
all he did was move into a new home, and you want to take it from there?
Yes, and then eventually when it rains, they congratulate him, basically. The story that I like to use that's similar is our ancient Greek ancestors had special magical stones. They were large boulders, and they believed that if you needed rain, you'd take a sacred tree branch, dip it in water, and beat the rock, and it would rain.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the funny thing is, this actually works. If you can take a rock and start beating it with a wet tree branch, and eventually it'll rain. You know, days, weeks, months later.
Years.
Right. Eventually it's going to rain. But by that time, you'll be so invested in it that when it actually does rain, it's going to seem very, very significant.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you know, there's a couple of different views of, you know, the uses for synchronicity. I think that synchronistic events are sort of the core of every culture's belief in magic. But mm-hmm. I think the heart of it is that we have the sort of ability to produce and to seek certain patterns in the environment.
Mm-hmm.
We see ourselves, what we're interested in, what we're thinking about, what we're feeling, projected externally. Now, some of this is purely psychological. We, you know, have the universe's largest supercomputer in our head. You know, this brain that is the most marvelous biocomputer imaginable. And it's very, very responsive to the conscious attention. So if you're looking for a pattern in particular in the environment around you, you're signaling the automated processes that filter our experience to highlight those patterns more than normal. So merely by the act of attention, you can be more aware of particular patterns. Now, that part is not particularly magical.
Mm-hmm.
But science has been telling us for many decades that we have about a 5% influence over random events in the environment. We actually change the patterns as well. And the book I wrote is about how that's possible and, mm-hmm. you know, what you can do with it.
Mm-hmm. Well, I just want to go to the magic thing for just a second, because this kind of caught my eye. From a pagan standpoint, the ability to create a synchronistic event is quite similar to casting a spell. In witchcraft, when a spell is cast, it is seen as the outcome already in place. It's a strong intention to get it there, to make it happen. And some say it's manipulating energy, but it's also manipulating the mind, isn't it, to evoke change somehow? So isn't there kind of a good tie-in there, huh?
It's a very good tie-in. I think that synchronicity is actually the core of all beliefs in magic. You know, our ancient ancestors danced with stag masks to have the game show up. They had noticed there was a connection between what the shaman or the priest did and how much game was there. They noticed that something about what we wanted and what we sought changed the odds in the environment. And, you know, I've sort of married modern string theory and modern physics into this idea and come up with, you know, a rational explanation on how it's possible. A lot has changed in the last 20 years in science. It used to be that scientists laughed at the magicians and the seers and the clairvoyants, you know, and the science fiction folks that talked about parallel universes and, you know, but it turns out the universe is a lot stranger than we ever thought it was. And mm-hmm. this kind of shifting between probabilities is probably actually the standard physical explanation of physics right now.
Mm-hmm. Well, there is that theory you mentioned, multidimensional, that we live in a multidimensional universe. It's a train of thought that many people scoff at. Others find it fascinating. And I don't believe that there's any hardcore evidence to prove or disprove the theory. But as you said, people's minds are opening up a little bit more to the possibility. But it does, that theory also does kind of help make some sense of the whole subject of synchronicity, doesn't it?
Yes, it does. If we're living in a universe where we are actually existing in an almost infinite amount of probabilities at once, there's no real reason why our conscious choice shouldn't be able to direct us through those paths somewhat at will. I'm not in the camp that says we create reality, but mm-hmm. I do believe we have an influence in reality. And I mm-hmm. believe that we have actually been able to measure that 5 or 6% influence scientifically for quite some time.
Mm-hmm. Do you think being able to help create our own synchronistic environments around us is always a good thing?
No, absolutely not.
Yeah.
Synchronicity is a reflection, and it reflects all of what we are, conscious, unconscious, good, bad, indifferent, you know, whatever pattern is there. I've worked with a lot of individuals, and there's been a lot of psychotherapists have noted that people have been highly traumatized tend to reproduce the trauma in the environment around them as synchronistic events.
Mm-hmm.
Similarly, people having ecstatic peak or religious experiences seem to experience them as manifestations of synchronistic events as well. They mm-hmm. seem driven by our emotion and our intent and our attention.
Mm-hmm. And it's just kind of weird because everybody's life, everybody's reality is different. So it's hard, like if somebody is able to do that, somebody else will do it in a different way. And the ability to create these events, sometimes people don't even realize that they can do it. And probably if these things happen repeatedly, they may think that they're a little bit delusional or just going a little bit mad, right?
Well, yeah. I mean, some of the clients I treat have this very problem. Mm-hmm. One of the examples I give in the book is a guy who came to me to be assessed. And, you know, I looked at his record, and it said he'd been diagnosed as a paranoid schizophrenic because he was having delusions. Now, schizophrenia is a cluster of symptoms, and I'm sitting across from this guy, and I'm not seeing a lot of that. I'm not seeing, you know, cognitive problems or, you know, flat emotion. But the guy is clearly troubled, and I ask him, well, what's going on? And he's telling me, well, you wouldn't believe me anyway. Nobody believes me. Well, you know, basically, try me. Mm-hmm. And he tells me that he believes that God has chosen him for some special task. He has no idea what it is, but God is constantly harassing him with coincidences. That televisions and radios talk to him, people come up to him and ask him for directions that are actually talking about what he's thinking. This has been going on since his 20s, and his life has been basically ruined because he starts telling people about it, and he loses his job, and his friends drifted away. And he didn't know what was going on or why, but, you know, he was feeling terribly troubled by it. And I didn't see any real signs that he wasn't thinking clearly or that he was delusional. So I told him, look, what you're experiencing is a form of your own thoughts directed back at you in the environment. Mm-hmm. So I said, next time you're experiencing, you know, a radio broadcast talking to you, instead of thinking it's God talking to you, pretend that it's Bugs Bunny, a cartoon character. Look for that personality. And he came back the next session with this kind of, oh my God, look on his face. And he said, you're right. I've been talking to myself for years. Nobody ever told me about this. And I said, well, you know, the bad news is we don't educate people about this. We teach people magical thinking is wrong when in fact we're all doing this constantly. And the good news is that now you know you can do this, you can have some fun. And he went on and, you know, and was able to repair parts of his life. On the other hand, if someone is truly delusional, is truly psychotic, they can also see synchronistic events. And the sort of personal myth they develop, you know, will be psychotic myth. And there's no way you can convince them otherwise. In that case, it is a mental illness. The first client, what happened to him was he saw one or two of these events in the environment and was like, whoa, what could possibly cause that? And the mm-hmm. only reference he had was sort of, you know, monotheistic God images. So, mm-hmm. believing that, it was reflected back to him, and suddenly he's in this great conversation with the Almighty, although he's talking to himself, chasing his own tail for years. When mm-hmm. in fact, you know, when in fact he could have been using this, you know, like pagan folk do, to like, you know, look for what they want in the environment and have a good time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, see, there's so much to it that people don't understand, or there's a lot that we don't understand that we can or cannot do within ourselves as well. And something like this and reading your book answers a lot of questions. It brings out a lot of thought-provoking ideas and, you know, it's kind of like being the master of your own universe in a sense, but knowing that you can be to some degree rather than, you know, Chicken Little, the sky is falling and there's nothing I can do about it sort of thing.
Right. That's why one of the words in the title is choice. It's actually knowing that you have a reasonable amount of choice in directing your attention and your own path through the world.
Mm-hmm. It's fascinating. Now, there's also kind of a tie into superstition and luck, isn't there? For example, we all have heard that breaking a mirror will bring 7 years of bad luck. And with that in mind, believing it, we might just create our own bad luck for 7 years.
That's exactly correct. And the same applies to, you know, talismans and good luck charms. It's your belief. It's the way you focus your attention.
Mm-hmm. And I always tell that, you know, people will say in the pagan world, well, you know, what talisman do you believe in? What do you, you know, what should I wear? I'm just new to this. And, you know, I said, well, you could tie a wet rock around your neck, and if you believe it, it will work. So it's whatever you believe that will protect you, whether it be a pentagram or a Star of David or a crucifix or whatever. It's your belief system in that that kind of helps you get through it and makes it work.
And well, the original magic wand is your spinal column. People are doing magic. It's not actually, it's natural technology. I mean, magic is a very poor word in a lot of ways because it implies something that can't be explained. Mm-hmm. I think it's actually a natural technology that we're all evolved to do this, and that, mm-hmm. you know, we don't actually need external symbols. You know, we mm-hmm. are, the nature of our being is our thoughts and emotions themselves do this automatically. And what we get back reflected as synchronistic events reflects our conscious choices and what we think and feel, our unconscious processes, and our spiritual connections as well. It's a full spectrum reflection that comes back at us with these events.
Well, what do you tell people that feel helpless about being able to control anything? Because a lot of people do. They just think that, you know, well, I'm going to sit here and the bullseye's on my forehead and I'm going to take what the universe sends out. How do you convince people or suggest to people that we do have some control here and we do have a say in what goes on in our lives?
Well, you know, there's an old Sufi saying. If a man puts a rope around his neck, God will provide somebody to pull it.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, you know, as a reflection, it gives back what we put out. So, mm-hmm. if someone is looking for what's wrong, the universe is extremely generous and will oblige them by reflecting back to them everything that's wrong.
Mm-hmm.
You need to. The reason choice is important is because we can control through meditation or using ritual to focus attention what we want to see, you know, what our thoughts are going to be about. And mm-hmm. you can direct them in any direction you want, but you have to make a choice about it. I think that, you know, if people want a positive outcome, then they look for what they actually want. Mm-hmm. They seek the pattern they want to show up. You know, mm-hmm. if you try to run away from something or try to avoid something, you're putting energy into the pattern you don't want to happen.
Mm-hmm.
And it happens. So, it's sort of a very simple thing. You know, if you want to look out into the world and you're looking for a particular pattern, then you look for that pattern. You don't look for what's in your way. You look for the thing you actually want.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's like I always tell people, you put negativity out there, it acts like a magnet. You know, just put a little bit out there and boing, you're going to be loaded with it for decades. You know, I think it's difficult sometimes for us to sometimes look beyond the obstacles and jump ahead to what we really want the outcome of. But it is possible. And that is a good thing to know and a good thing for people to kind of get that in your head, too. We do have some power. We can make things better, doesn't necessarily have to wait for the other shoe to drop.
Well, I also think that, you know, it's not an unlimited ability. I mean, the research that's been done on this says that we have about a 5% influence over randomness.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, over time, 5% is a lot. 5% mm-hmm. can change the course and direction of your life, consistently applied. And mm-hmm. What I'm trying to do, I'm trying to show people, is how to approach this reasonably, within, you know, the limits of what's actually there. Not the fantasy, but, you know, the reality of what they can actually do already.
Mm-hmm. Well, and for those who don't know that the reality is possible, that's a very good start. And then there are people that kind of hang on to synchronicity, always looking for the reason that it's there. And sometimes there can be a, quote, synchronistic event that is so obvious, and yet, you know, they may try as they may to see what it means, you know, but not be able to figure out, like the example of a bus ticket being the same number as a theater ticket, then having the same number show up in a phone call later, and you know that same number shows on your clock and everything. And I mean, while that's to me certainly coincidental, it doesn't necessarily have some kind of a deeper meaning, does it?
No, they're often very direct reflections. I mean, we have a lot of random thoughts and a lot of patterns that are sort of just about the nuts and bolts of living, you know, that we repeat. So that example is from Carl Jung. He has another example where, you know, synchronicities around fish started showing up around him a lot. Mm-hmm. And, you know, he theorized that there was an archetype of fish somewhere out there making this happen. Mm. Well, in the actuality, he was doing research on fish symbols. His thoughts were reflecting all over the place. It doesn't mean there's any deeper meaning. However, the unconscious is vast, well-organized, and smarter than we are. You know, I like to tell people that the part that we think is us, the conscious part, is about the size of a walnut on the frontal lobe of the brain. The rest of the maybe, you know, 95% of our gray matter is a miraculously powerful supercomputer, very active, very organized, and very intelligent. Those processes are automated. They do all the grunt work of reality for us. Think of it this way. What we are is sort of biological supercomputers. We have billions of sensory nerves pointed into the environment. They're all digital. They operate on on and off signals. The brain takes in trillions of signals every second and coordinates them all into an area of memory that gives us this representation of reality that you are experiencing right now. It's a stunning feat of computational reality making. And we do that normally. Okay? The processes that we do consciously are sort of geared towards guiding us through the outside world to get our needs met, you know, matching our internal demands with the external world. You know, so the automated processes don't always reflect something that the conscious mind thinks is vitally important or makes any sense out of. But they are part of what the automated processes inside us are doing for us anyway. Sometimes we also have synchronistic events that appear as metaphors. In the same way that when you dream, often the dream is a metaphor for an emotion or an experience that you've had, often synchronistic events are metaphors for something you're continuing to process in your life. So in a way, you can look at these events in the environment as a window into your own unconscious, into your own processes. And some of those processes contain useful information for us.
Right. It's a question of digging it out then.
Right.
Well, you know, it's also, you know, I want to go back to when we're talking about superstitions and how we can create that bad luck. Isn't it true that often people who claim to have a lot of synchronistic events, let's say somebody has an affinity for butterflies, okay? And so they see butterflies everywhere. They see pictures of butterflies, the butterflies on the TV, butterfly flies into their backyard or something. But isn't that, in a sense, also because they do have an affinity for butterflies that they tend to see it more because they're paying more attention?
Absolutely. Absolutely. You know, there is an old alchemical saying, as above, so below, that what happens physically always has its parallels sort of metaphysically. So, you know, the thought processes that leave the person filtering for experience of butterflies, like make them notice them more, are the same processes that actually create that 5% difference in the environment. The person probably is actually experiencing more butterflies than another person because they think about them so much. But, you know, we tend not to remember things that we don't think are important.
Right.
So another person walking through the same backyard may have no inkling there are butterflies there and not remember any. But the person who's interested in them, has emotional value to them, may see 20 or 30.
Yeah.
Now, synchronicity maybe puts two or three extra there.
just for the heck of it, right?
Right.
Just to stay honest. You were talking about Carl Jung, and in your book, you say his model of synchronicity was the first, is still popular, and is wrong.
Completely.
Where did he go astray? Where did he go astray?
Okay. He had a couple of problems with synchronicity. He was already on thin ice with his theory of the collective unconscious. He was basically talking to Victorian-era thinkers. So something so collective and mythological was beyond them. If he had come out and said, we cause synchronistic events, you can clearly see that our emotions and thoughts make these, he would have been laughed out of his profession, and the rest of his very good model and very good therapeutic work would have been discredited. So he really couldn't say that. What he said was that there may be these universal patterns somewhere in what he called psychoid space, which is sort of, you know, another plane of consciousness where the internal and external world are the same thing. They're outside of time and space, and these patterns cause your thoughts and the events around you to cluster into the same formations. In other words, you and the external events are being influenced by these archetypal patterns. Mm-hmm. The problem is that there are no archetypes. You know, it's a spurious concept. People produce this. You can do it. You're doing it right now, in fact. So is everybody that's listening. Everybody mm-hmm. produces these events. There was a researcher named J.B. Ryan at Duke University in the 30s, and he was a psychologist. And he had a gambler came into his office one day, and paraphrasing the story, said, look, Doc, I can make the dice come up, you know, a little bit better odds than, you know, than random chance. So instead of throwing the guy out of his office, he broke out six pairs of dice in a notebook and had the guy do it. He said, okay, make the number six come up more often than usual. So he did 100 dice tosses and averaged it out. Sure enough, the dice were coming up, you know, about 5 or 6% number six more often than usual. So he spent about 30 years trying to figure this out. And he was able to determine that acts of interest and attention affect people's ability to do this. They're directly related to our psychological states. Mm-hmm. Carl Jung saw this. And in his desperation to validate his model, he said, yes, this is synchronicity in a laboratory. And then people said, well, yeah, but Ryan's saying that human beings are influencing this. And he said, no, there must be an archetype of hopeful expectancy that you know, makes you do this. It's like, no, it's a really weak explanation. It's an unnecessary explanation. Mm-hmm. Modern string theory and its, you know, infinite amount of probable parallel universes, which is now the standard model in physics, gives a better explanation, which is that, you know, we are somewhat multidimensional beings, that we don't exist in one probability at a time. We exist in an infinite variable amount of them. Mm-hmm. Now, some events are more improbable than others. So if you think of probability as distance, the likelihood that I'll go grab a glass of water and take a drink is a very short distance. The likelihood I'll become president of the United States is a vast distance. Mm-hmm. Synchronistic events happen when you travel distances in probability, you know, distances that cause you to be in probabilities where the external events match up with what you're thinking. We are a lot more than we appear to be. You know, it used to be that we thought the Earth was flat. Then, you know, we started saying the Earth was round. Right now, most people believe that there's only one actual reality. There's a linear timeline. There's only one probability. I think what people are going to find is that they are already multidimensional. As you sit here, you're already traveling through an infinite amount of probabilities, and your thoughts and your feelings guide you through them. Now, we don't have an infinite ability to steer ourselves. We're not, you know, massive, huge beings. We don't have sort of, you know, spiritual rocket engines on us. But we have a little bit of travel space, and that's the 5 or 6% influence that I'm talking about.
What do you think is a person, people's misconception, the biggest misconception about synchronicity?
That something other than their own self is causing it.
Okay.
You know, I think that in Zen Buddhism, there's states of Satori, which are unity with the environment. The barriers between self and everything else is said to disappear. Synchronistic events are a small, tiny version of that, where you begin to see that parts of yourself, parts of your thoughts and feelings are manifested as the environment. We are not separate beings. That's an illusion. Mm-hmm. One of the amazing things that Einstein said, besides that matter and energy is equivalent, is that there's no separate objects. you know, two particles separated by space. In high school, they teach you that they're two separate chunks of something.
Mm-hmm.
Einstein said, no, there's one energy field, and it's a little bit denser in some places than others. So everything is innately connected. So you could say that everybody is sort of twists in the same fabric. You know, there's the illusion mm-hmm. of a separateness where the twist is, but actually everything is made out of the same energy.
You know, a lot of this is kind of hard maybe to get people's heads around and everything, but it does make sense in the great scheme, you know, without having to sit and go deep, deep, deep into it. It does make a lot of sense if you, you know, the way you put it. You know, I learned a lot reading your book.
Let me put a little more fun way, okay?
Okay.
Everybody out there right now listening to this, you are creating your own synchronistic events around you constantly. Whatever you think, whatever you believe, and whatever you look for shows up in the environment around you. Usually you filter it out because, you know, you don't know you're doing it. If you look, it shows up more often. Humans have this amazing ability. You can play with the environment like it's a video game. You can cause themes of events to show up. And you can do this for your own amusement. This is part of the joy of existence. You know, and I think that, you know, we get into heavy-duty explanations of the philosophy or the science and miss out the pure sort of joy of being able to play with the environment and the universe around us.
Well, when you put it that way, yeah, it kind of makes it more fun. It kind of gives everybody a chance to feel a little bit in control rather than in the victim seat. You know, this is what's going to happen, and, you know, playing Chicken Little, the sky's falling and I need to hide real quick. Now, there's something else that you talked about in your book, artificial psychic phenomena. Let's talk a little bit about that.
Okay. So synchronistic events reflect all of your processes, what you're thinking and choosing to think and feel consciously, the huge amount of unconscious processes that are going on, you know, reprocessing experiences you've had. It's a full spectrum reflection. So a lot of unconscious things are going on as well. If someone has some sort of psychic ability or talent, that gets projected as well. So instead of sort of looking at your internal imagery to try to get images about, you know, information you're looking for, you can actually watch the environment, and the environment will provide the information to you because you're looking at your own thought patterns. It's, you know, the totality of what we are gets reflected back to us. So, you know, if someone has any kind of ability, they can use the external world as a screen to read that. You know, most forms of, you know, people use divination systems, for instance, to try to get clairvoyant information. Some people look at crystals and form trances to get images. Some people try to get it through their dreams. Whatever the core is of that ability, you can also manifest it as synchronistic events to look for clues in the environment about things that you're interested in. You know, the caveat is that, you know, you have to know yourself really well.
Mm-hmm.
Just as in people who, you know, try to develop clairvoyant or, you know, extrasensory abilities, you're always fighting through your normal thought patterns. What you're experiencing is usually somewhat highlighted versions of your own thoughts. I mean, there's no big secret to telepathy, you know. You listen to your own thoughts and see what in your sort of inner dialogue seems a little louder than normal.
Mm-hmm.
We always experience things in terms of what we are already. And you can do that either in purely internal methods, or you can do it with synchronicity. Tarot cards, I Ching, reading tortoise shells, any way it's been done throughout history, is actually simply using synchronistic events. You're looking for patterns of your thought and feeling reflected in the environment. In the case of something like tarot cards, they've actually tried to set up a language to talk to the unconscious with. You sort of study the cards and you have agreed upon meanings for them, and then you sort of use them as a conversation with yourself, you know, to interpret what the unconscious is trying to tell you.
Mm-hmm.
And everybody that does the cards knows that, you know, if you don't go in with a clear mind, what you get is readings that reflect your concerns. You know, not
mm-hmm.
the person you're doing the reading for.
Right. That makes sense. How can we get synchronicity to work for us in our daily lives? And more importantly, is there a simple way to recognize and understand it? I know we've been talking a little bit about it, but...
Well, you know, it's a shameless plug for the book, but that's what the book's about.
You know? I was hoping you would do that.
Yeah. You know, the book has 7 games that teach people how to use synchronicity in the environment. Would you mind if I talked about one of them for a few minutes?
No, please.
Okay. There's a game called All the World's a Stage. Now, it's a famous line from Shakespeare that all the world's a stage and that we're merely players. You can pretend, okay, this is a way of looking for synchronicity in the environment. Mm-hmm. You pretend that you're on stage, that the entire reality around you is actually an engineered set on which you and the people around you play out their lives. In science fiction, like things like Star Trek, they have holodecks that mm-hmm. create entire fantasy universes for you that you get to mm-hmm. play in. Now, you're going to look at the environment, and you're going to pretend that you're on one of these holodeck stages. Now, the difference is, you know you're on the holodeck stage now. The players around you don't know this right now. They're sort of so engrossed in their roles, they don't know they're acting. Now, the stage that you're on is maintained by a stage crew. There are people in the background, sort of, you know, living in the walls of reality and time and space, that arrange events to happen when people meet, you know, what the license plate on the car in front of you says while you're thinking about something. They create the synchronistic events and the general random circumstances of your life. Now, being on stage and aware, you want to signal to your stage crew that you know they're there. You want to basically say hello and wait for them to signal back. So you look at the environment for a coincidence, something that is too odd to be random chance that happens right in front of you that's related to what you're thinking. And after a few days, you should find a few of them as if the stage crew is talking back to you. Eventually, you can start carrying on conversations and asking for certain themes to appear in the production that you're playing in right now. The fun thing about this is I give this to people, and a certain amount of people will come back to me in a few weeks and go, oh, wow, it's so incredible. I didn't know the world was run by angels, and there's these aliens creating, you know, events around people for their benefit. And I go, no, dude, no. You made the story up, okay? We started out on a stage, and you made the assumptions on the way in, remember? And they go, oh, yeah, that's right. And in reality, we do this all the time. I mean, I think, you know, religions and politicians and all kinds of people that are caught up in belief systems that we go, how can they possibly think that? It's because they think it, and then they see it reflected, and then they believe it. Mm-hmm. And, you know, and one of my favorite sayings is, don't believe everything you think. And with synchronicity, you're looking at a mirror. And if you can do it maturely, you know, you do it as an adult, knowing that you're playing sort of call and response, you know, with reality, you can have a great deal of fun with this. You know, it doesn't have to be some heavy metaphysical thing. It can be an absolute joy and a wonder.
We can write our own scripts.
Absolutely. It's about choice.
Mm-hmm. Which is obviously, the key word here. I mean, it is all about choice, and it's a choice that I think people sometimes don't know that they have.
Well, they're not taught this. They're not taught about it. What do our parents do to us? We grow up, and until we're 5 or 6 years old, we're wishing on stars, and, you know, they teach us that, you know, if you only wish hard enough, things will come true, and magic is real in the world, and, you know, they show us all these Walt Disney movies, and, you know, and then somewhere around 7 or 8, they go, look, man, time to grow up. Okay, magic's not real, it's time to get linear, time to get cause and effect, and get ready to get a job, and, you know, lose your magical thinking.
Right.
Well, that's like an act of cognitive castration, because, you know, there is magic in the world. My personal belief is it's actual physics. It's real technology. Mm-hmm. You know, an example would be we're constantly saying, my God, in 70 years we're going to have fusion reactors that'll take a couple of thousandth of a gram of helium-3 and power a whole city. You know, isn't technology grand that we can overcome nature like this? Well, you know, the sun has been burning 11 million tons of hydrogen a second for billions of years. It's a nuclear reactor, and it's real technology. I mean, grand scale. I have a MacBook that I write on, a wonderful little computer. Okay, the brain that's in your head right now is more powerful than every computer system on the planet wired together at once. Nature produces the real technology. We have pale imitations. And being equipped like this with this kind of technology naturally, we should be having some fun with it.
And the ability to be able to have fun with it is even more fun.
Yeah, people have choices. People have choices. I think that one way of controlling populations is to convince them they have no power. And, you know, I think fundamentalist religious systems have done an outstanding job of disempowering people over the centuries.
Yeah, it's who's got the joystick, you know, who's controlling it, you know, and it's always good to know that you can take it back and play your own game. It's just, it's absolutely amazing. And there are several people in the chat room that are beginning to ask the question, which we all need an answer for: where can people find your book? And do you have a website address that you can leave with us as well?
Sure. The book is Synchronicity, The Art of Coincidence, Choice, and Unlocking Your Mind. You can order from Amazon, Barnes & Noble. You can get paper copies. You can get electronic copies. There's various independent bookstores around the web that have it. I have a website called howsynchronicityworks.com, which, yes, it is a shameless plug for the book, but there's also a lot of stories and general information about synchronicity and people commenting and some forums. And I'd love to have you stop in and tell your own stories.
Oh, you don't want to get into my brain and play my stories, but no, it's true. Just sometimes we just need to, again, realize that we do have choices. And thank you so much for popping in and making that point clearly obvious to everybody, because, again, it's sometimes we don't realize that. But this is a fascinating subject. We could go on for probably another 3, 4, or 5 hours. And hopefully you'll be able to come back and join us, and we'll talk a little bit more about it. So I want to thank you so much for joining me tonight. And as usual, I want to thank everybody that's tuning in. If you have missed part of the podcast, you want to hear it again, please go to www.para-x.com, click on the On Demand tab, and scroll down to Stirring the Cauldron, and you can listen to all some of the other great Para-X shows as well. And please join me next week when my guest will be Lisa J. Smith. She'll be back with us to make up for her last visit, which actually got us all lost in cyberspace. And the week after, we'll be talking to author Ivo Dominguez about his new book, Casting a Sacred Space. So until next time, everybody, blessed be and merry meet again. Good night.
This has been another edition of Stirring the Cauldron with Marla Brooks. Be sure to tune in next week at the same time for another great guest and more fun. Any rebroadcast or other use of this program without permission is strictly prohibited. Copyright 2009.
You have been listening to the Para-X Radio Network.